Do you really need experience to become a cloud architect, solutions architect, enterprise architect, or even a chief technology officer? Well, the answer is no, and I can give you examples of people who have done it without experience, but you have to possess everything that employers want when they say they're looking for experience. So in this video, we're going to talk about what is it that employers want? Why is it they actually ask for experience, and what can you do if you don't have that experience? So if you ever were to look at a job description, and if you looked in a job description, you might notice that it always wants 5 to 10 years of experience. And it doesn't matter if you're looking for a hotel receptionist, a waiter or waitress to serve food in a restaurant, or a solutions architect. Every job wants 5 to 10 years of experience. And it's not necessarily experience they're looking for, it's something else. And that's what we're going to talk about. And I can give you examples. For example, Nafoumi got his first job as a chief technology officer, and I worked with him after his training. Yvonne Tambo was a college student who was hired by AWS as a solutions architect after our training, not an associate solutions architect, but a full solutions architect. Delroy was hired by CDW as a security architect after our training, and he was an emergency medical technician. Wallace Agana, for example, was hired by JPMorgan Chase Bank as an enterprise architect, and his last job was in sales. And you can get any job you want, but you have to possess the things that come with experience, even if it's not to experience, through experience. So what is it? What is it employers are really looking for? They're looking for a few things. They're looking for competency, and they're looking at your judgment. And you have to have the same level of competency to be hired as if you had experience, and you also need that level of professional judgment. So we're gonna break these two concepts down in the video. I'm gonna begin with competency. An employer just can't hire you if you don't have competency, and competency is the ability to do the job and do it well. But it has to be this job, the job that you're actually applying for. So if you're applying to be an airplane pilot, it doesn't matter if you're a great physician. If you are applying to be a cloud architect or a solutions architect, it's about your ability to design a solution to enhance your customer's business performance, not your ability to code or configure or work with infrastructure as code or work with Linux. That's someone else's job, it's not ours. So you have to have the right skills for the right job. So let's say we were dealing with a cloud architect or an AWS solutions architect or an enterprise architect for that matter. These are the kind of skills they really need. The ability to solve business problems and technical problems, which means you have to understand business for this role. And you also have to understand technology, not how to build the technology, but how the technology works and how it's fit together. Now, the architect doesn't create an architecture by themselves. In most cases, we architects create and lead an architecture team. Now, as architects, we do a lot of responses to requests for information, requests for proposals, requests for quotes or pricing. So you have to be able to lead and drive an RFP response. Now, as an architect, we have to manage stakeholders and vendors. And you have to have those skills to do the job regardless of where you've got them. You could have gotten them in sales or management, but you have to have those skills. Now, as an architect, we have to communicate with the C-suite. And there are times where you'll have to convince the C-suite why they're going to spend $1 billion on your technology, and you're going to have to show the business impact for them. You'll have to manage stakeholders as an architect. You'll have to manage vendors. You'll have to deliver an effective presentation. You'll have to be able to close a deal. Lead an engineering team during a proof of concept testing. And guess what? If you have these skills, a great attitude, and the ability to create good architectural designs, and you go on a cloud architect interview, an enterprise architect interview, a solutions architect interview, and you'll get hired regardless of your experience or lack thereof because you have the right skills. Now, the second thing that we also do care about when we hire people, which often comes out of experience, is judgment. See, if we're dealing with, say, a cloud architect or an enterprise architect, we're looking for a strategist that needs to be non-biased. When I hire an engineer, I don't want them to be biased towards one technology provider or even any technology. Everybody on my team, I want to be able to think of the businesses and the business's needs. So the same way, if I go to a doctor, I want them to care for me. I don't want the doctor to be biased and say, I'm only going to prescribe Pfizer drugs because I have stock in Pfizer. And Pfizer makes some wonderful pharmaceuticals. But if I go to my doctor, I want them to be able to use every medication in the entire world made by whomever to take care of any medical conditions I would want. have. And that's exactly what we look for when we're looking to hire people, people without bias or favoritism. So how do people get themselves in trouble? When we begin our careers, we often go to certifications. Now, this is a good thing, but it can also be a bad thing, depending upon how much a person does this. So if it's a good thing, because the certifications will give, you know, 5-10% of the elements that we need in our career, which is a good thing. It's a small percentage of what we need. But the problem is a certification will show a very artificial picture of the world. It's almost like science fiction in my mind if you look at what's taught in the certification, for example, what's going on in reality. And that artificial perspective would make it scary. So it's only if a person, typically speaking, has a lot of certifications from the same vendor. For example, let's say someone got 13 AWS certifications. By the time they're done those 13 AWS certifications, they're going to think that the world revolves around AWS. And they're going to always be thinking towards the AWS stuff, because what's in an AWS certification? The AWS stuff, and there's nothing wrong with that. But here's the reality. 98% of enterprise clients are multi-cloud, which means we can't use at least 50% of the stuff that's taught in an AWS certification. And in a real enterprise, not a certification environment, the client's going to have 200,000 IP addresses if they're an enterprise, maybe 10,000 routes in the routing table. They're going to have a data center, 3 private clouds, 5 petabytes of data, and 10 different networking and security vendors. So what you need to know is to be able to separate what's reality, who would you use, when you would use them, and why would you use them, from the science fiction and the bias that would actually come from a certification. So I'm not saying don't get certifications. Here's my recommendation, and here's how we get people hired all the time as cloud architects, enterprise architects, and solutions architects. The first thing that you need to do is learn the underlying technology, the real technology. So if I'm dealing with a cloud architect, for example, the underlying technology is the same technology in the network and the data center. And why? All the cloud is a virtualized network and a data center. So if I know my network, my routers, my switches, and what they do and how they do it and how they do everything, I already have part of the cloud knowledge. Now, if I understand the data center, which is things like servers and virtual machines and containers and container orchestration, for example, and compute, and that compute could be functions as a service, like a Lambda function, which we can still do in our data center, or an Azure function. The compute could be application virtualization, where we just upload the code and it runs, for example. The virtualization could be virtual machines, containers, what have you. So all this stuff is data center stuff, not cloud stuff. If I understand storage, block storage, object storage, file storage, guess what? I understand all the storage on all clouds. And it's the same storage we've done for 30 years. If I understand the various types of next generation firewalls, I understand firewalls, and I can understand how to select the right ones based upon the protection they would provide my organization. If I understand NoSQL databases and relational databases, I understand these relational databases anyway, and it doesn't matter which cloud or which data center. So if you really want to build your skills, and if you don't want to have that bias, and if you want to come across like you've got the experience, learn the underlying technology. Truly master that underlying technology, because if it's networking, if it's IP addressing, routing, route aggregation, traffic engineering, BGP security, guess what? It's the same on all clouds and all data centers for the last 30 or 40 years. If it comes to security and you're learning application security and secure coding practices and encryption and cryptography and network security and SIEM systems and data loss prevention systems, firewalls, IDS, IPS systems, identity and access management systems, it's the same on all the clouds. So if you want to be a cloud architect or an AWS solutions architect or an enterprise architect or any tech professional for that matter, learn the technology that you're actually working with, and for architects, learn how it fits together. And when you understand the technology, you can be hired with or without a certification, but the certifications themselves will never get someone hired because they create that artificial environment, that synthetic environment, and they don't provide the knowledge that one needs to do to actually do the job. So learn the skills and then get certified. And if you wanted to be a cloud architect or a solution architect, get a professional cloud certification. Don't get 6, don't get 10. Get one of them, like the Google Professional Cloud Architect or the Azure Solutions Architect Expert or the AWS Solutions Architect Pro. And that's learning the names of the cloud services that you'll already know if you know the network and the data center. Now, at this point, You've got something that's good for you, that stands out, that's there. And if you want to get a couple other certifications for an architect, do so. Maybe a TOGAF 10 that teaches you an architecture framework and the step-by-steps to complete an architecture. And it's not a vendor base, so it's not going to bias you. If you're interested in security, maybe add a CISSP, one of the best security architecture certifications in the world. And I teach to all my clients because it's so good at getting them interview and providing the management architecture perspective of security. So at the end of the day, what is an employer really looking for? They don't care about your experience. They care about your ability to do the job and do it well. And they care about you being fair, non-biased, and having a real perspective of the world and some good judgment. Get this, do this, and guess what? You can have any job in the world that you want. If you want to learn how to become a cloud architect, a solutions architect, a security architect, an AI architect, an enterprise architect, or even a network architect, join us for one of our free architecture webinars. We'll go over what we do in these roles, the skills that you need in these roles, and we'll do anything we can to help guide you in your career, and they're all completely free. If you've been, and how to register for these is in the description of this video. If you've enjoyed this video, please give it a like, subscribe to our channel, and hit the bell to be notified of new videos to assist you in your technology career. This is Mike Gibbs signing off for now, and I look forward to seeing you in another video. Take care.